Hi everyone, are you able to hear me? Right. Hello. Okay, I could see a lot of people are able to hear me, and I could also see that a lot of people are not in a position to, because most of them have not actually joined the audio. No, that's fine. I guess, yeah. Yeah, we can all respond in chat. That's what the host says. All right. Hi guys. I'm Praveen and I'm actually from London. Currently, I'm in London. I'm originally from India in Chennai, and I would be taking you through this awesome journey of like learning the whole full stack web application development in a more interactive way. So anyone who is having any questions or anything, you can just raise your hand and you can get yourself unmuted as well. So I'll speak to the host to give you those permissions, because I'm just a co-host. I don't know whether I have that permissions anyway. So right. So a lot of people have raised their hands, but a lot of people have also not able to join the audio, I guess. Just give me like 2 more minutes and I'll confirm you with that. Right. Let's get on to the session. So we can use the chat, it seems, and anyone who is so I need to. This is gonna be a. It's gonna be a kind of like a session. It's the first session is gonna be completely like a friendly, casual, learning to know about each other session. So this would be a good chance to for me as well as for you all to express what exactly is your idea about like how much you know in JavaScript basics, so that I will be able to better understand about you and then give you the best out of the whole session. So before that, I just wanted to give you a brief of what we are going to do. So the first thing which we are going to work on is everyone in the industry would like to know more about the version control systems and how things are happening in the real life, real world. So the first thing we will be learning about is different types of version control systems, and one particular version control system here, it is called Git. And a lot of people are using, I hope a lot of people know about Git. And then the other thing is we will also be learning how to use GitHub, and we will be also using learning to use how to use GitHub and also create open source projects, how to contribute to open source project, find out what exactly is the GitHub workflow. And then finally, we will also try to work on a completely full stack web application. So that is going to be the complete idea about this course. And the first thing is we will be venturing into Git and GitHub. Then the next session will be about basics of JavaScript and front end. These three sessions will be a brush up session for those people who have not got much experience with these technologies, will be able to get a good idea about what exactly they are. And now what we will be doing is we are going to create something like an Instagram application. That is what we will be doing right now. And with that, you will be learning the basics of HTML, JavaScript, CSS, the front end parts, and then moving on to already existing. Like for example, if you go to any company or join any organization, you are not going to build anything from scratch. So that's the first thing we will be working on. So there are already pre-built frameworks, pre-built applications, and on top of it will be you will be starting to work on. So this is what is going to happen in the real life applications. So what we will be doing is we will take popular platform, like popular framework, like Bootstrap, which is a CSS framework in this case. And then we will use that to build an application on top of it. The application we are going to build is called Leadstagram, and it is almost similar to Instagram, and it is going to be built with along with everyone. Like, we all are going to build and work together. So that is what is going to happen. So when we are going to start building that, I'm going to definitely unmute all. So make sure you don't have any other noises in around you. And everyone is going to participate in it. It's going to be extremely interactive session. And I would also use this today's opportunity to talk to each and every one of you. There are like 90 people. Yes, I know. So even if it is going to be like a minute per person, it's going to take like more than 1.5 hours for me. But yes, I'm ready to spend that. And we are going to look into what all things, how we are going to schedule this. And apart from this, so you will be learning, starting with JavaScript, basics of JavaScript, and then there will be like a slightly an advanced version of JavaScript, which is going to be ECMA script 7. So ES7 is kind of like released last year, last but 1 year, like 2 years ago. And then last year it was ES2019, and this year ES2020. Not many features in ES2020 are available in our browsers at the moment, but we will try to use a lot of things using transpilers. So a transpiler is something which is gonna take your high level JavaScript or the JavaScript with new features and then convert it into a low level or like the older browser supported versions of JavaScript, and it will allow that to install it. So, right, any questions so far? Please leave your comments and I'm gonna answer everything. How was it? I mean, like, how? What do you think about the plan? Is the plan okay?
Guys, you're provided with a yes or no symbol. These are the reaction symbols that you have. If anyone feels like to give any reactions, they are free to do so. So kindly, cooperate with the mentor.
Okay, great. So I'll just wait for a few seconds. Okay, there are a lot of S reactions happening. That's nice. Okay, superb. So let's go ahead with the next thing. So today we are gonna get into some kind of like a deep discussion about everyone here. Thank you. And can you all your experience on the things which I'm showing? So let me share my screen right now. There is nothing, I haven't prepared any slides or anything because I want this to be an interactive session and I want everyone to be like involved in this. So I thought of like going deeply diving it directly. But from the next sessions, we will be going on completely a practical basis, and we will be working on things like we will start with Git, as I said to you. So we will tomorrow we will be working with Git. Day after tomorrow, we will be working with JavaScript, and then we will start working on the real project, which is based on React.js. And I believe everyone would have got the the course structure. I just prepared it to an extent. This is my first time I even did something like this. So please forgive me if it is like bad or something, but I'm definitely taking your comments. And if you have any feedback, please do let me know. And for the first thing, what I'm gonna ask you do is, can you, one moment. Okay, so I'm gonna share my screen now. And thank you. So yeah. I hope everyone is able to see my screen, and let me open the, oh wow, we do have the polling as well. That's nice. Okay. So I want you all to let me know I don't know whether I can, I'll be able to maximize the screen. So the first thing I want to know from you is, how skilled are you in the following areas? So out of five being best, one being I'm completely new. Can you all comment it out so that I just, any of the host, can you tell me what would be the best way to get the details? Like, it would be like, there are 90 people going to respond me right now. So I need to know how skilled are they. Based on that, I need to like adjust my pace and other things. And I'm ready to, I haven't even started what I need to put. Wait, guys. Stop. I didn't ask anything on that. All right. So first thing will be Git, GitHub, HTML and CSS, JavaScript, jQuery, Bootstrap, React.js, Node.js. So we are at the end of this whole course. We will be learning all these things. So if you wanna tell me, okay, it looks like perfectly everyone is beginner here. Then in that case, so these are the whole thing. These are the complete stuff we are gonna learn. All right. So I'll go one by one each to you, and I'll explain you everything in one. I'm just looking at the comments. Nice. It looks like there are a lot of people who are extremely zero in starting. So this is the best scenario to, you know, start with the basics. All right. So, okay. Zero is not even there. That's great. All right, then. Then you guys are the complete, the best audience ever then in that case. All right. Okay. So we will start with the extreme basics. Okay. So first thing I'll... Okay, superb. All right, thanks. Thanks for the comments. So we will start with the basics of Git and GitHub right now. So first thing I would like to introduce what exactly is Git. So let's go with gitscm.com. All right. Oh, that's nice. Like, we have people from other departments as well. This is really good. So for example, Ankit, make sure you are learning a lot from this so that it will be helpful in your case as you are a mechanical engineer. Nice. Okay, great. So this is Git. Git is actually a version control system, one of the version control systems available in the market. And the different version control systems that we have are, one would be the most common, the most popular one is Git. How many of you have not heard of Git as a software or as something? Like, you haven't ever heard of this one? Is there anyone? Okay.
You can all raise your hands for that.
There are a lot of people raising the hands. Yes. Okay, that's interesting. There are like loads of people. So, okay, now, yeah, thanks. Okay, so for people who have who do not know what is Git and GitHub, so this is GitHub. GitHub is a company that uses Git software to as the back powered thing to make the whole what do you call this, to run the whole thing. So GitHub is the, you can say like GitHub is the Git's online version control, you know, something like a front office for Git. So Git is a server, so it is the server software, and it also has the client software. So for those people who don't know what exactly is a server software and a client software, generally we have like something like three-tier architecture and two-tier architectures in the web application development and these kind of similar development in environments. So what we are completely concentrating right now is a three-tier architecture, which has a development, there will be a access database layer, there will be a business logic layer or an application program layer, and there is a presentation layer. Whatever you see in front, like for example, this whole screen which says built for developers and the website, etc. Those things are written using HTML and CSS, and most probably there will be JavaScript content as well. So this one comprises of presentation layer. So this presentation layer is just like your printed paper. It has beautiful graphics. It has all these nice illustrations and everything, but it does not have anything related to, it cannot be done. It cannot do anything. Like for example, if you go to your Gmail or like, let's say you go here, right? Okay. So this is your Gmail account. So if you open this, it shows you a text box and it has a next button, etc. But in case if this is a printed sheet, you can't do anything, right? So it is like that. That's HTML. Then if you click on these things and when you start interactions, you have to give some inputs to the server to process. Obviously, as a normal printed paper, you won't be able to do much with this page, right? So in that case, what you would do is you need some kind of an application, a software application preferably, that takes your input, like for example, your email, username, etc. And then it takes in the, it processes the input from the user and tries to give you a suitable output. For example, if I say like hello or something like that, and it something like hello world, it's gonna check with the database and see if that hello world account is there. First time when the account was not there, it was saying there is no Google account associated with it. And now since the account is there, it directly went to the password field. These things are done by the application server. So application server is a server which has a lot of different privileges. By privileges, I mean that application server has the privilege of taking the data from customers as you or users as you. So you are the end users. And just a quick question. So this one is about the full stack web development, right? Any of the hosts, can you confirm me?
Yes, sir, it is.
Yeah, some people are asking about career development and mentoring. So that is also
I would like to inform this particular session is only for full stack development. The rest of the sessions will be communicated to you later, but this is only for full stack development.
So Dev, you will be getting to know about when it is, but this will be definitely interesting to you. In case if you don't understand, do let me know and I'll try my level best to like explain it in a easy way. Sahaj, you raised your hand. What's up? Instead of raising your hands, just comment your message on the chat. I'm looking at the chat as well. So I would immediately be happy to clarify your questions then and there. So yeah, as I was talking, so this one is a presentation layer where you will be able to give your inputs. And from the presentation layer, the business layer is a software that's gonna take your user input, and then it will have the access to the multiple things. For example, it would have access to the file systems where you can upload files or download files, modify files, etc. And then you would have access to the business logic business layer will have access to the database where you can store your relational data or something like that. And apart from that, this can also set session. So which means it can also uniquely identify you, like you are the person who requested this and I would be giving you an answer for this, something like that. So you can consider this like a pipe. Okay. So when this person, there are like three people connected to this server using like a water pipe. And then if one person asks a question, this server has to respond in that pipe, right? So that is called as session management. It keeps track of which user sent what through the pipes. Right. So this way, this is the front end and then, okay. So this is the way it is gonna respond based on having the sessions in mind. So this is the session management. This is one of the features of a server as well. So whenever you give an input here, it will be processed by server by checking the database which is available with it, and then it checks whether this particular username is available in the server, and then if it is available, it shows a different screen. That's how the whole thing executes. So let's get back onto the Git and GitHub. So now, as a Git, as a version control software, it can be installed both in client and the server. The main reason why Git is installed in server is you need a remote repository, like a common repository for every one of us. Like for example, we all are gonna use a GitHub account, and then we will be working on the code collaboratively with everyone. So for example, if I have a set of code, like for example, I'm sharing the screen and typing some code and then saving it in my local machine, it will be available only till you see the video here, right? So it will not be possible for you to get that, download the code or something like that. Right now, do you all have any questions?
I see too many hand raises. So I will unmute you one by one and you can ask the questions to the mentor, right? So just a minute. Pravas, Kumar, I have unmuted you. Please ask the question.
No question I have.
Okay, please lower your hand.
So right now, if you have, if no one has any questions, those people who have raised the questions, I can just give the names. It's Pankaj, Adarsh, Rajdeep, Jindal, and Roshan right now. Okay.
Adarsh, Parashar, I've unmuted you. Any questions? No questions. Pankaj Kumar, I have unmuted you.
Okay. I don't think he's unmuted. Okay, Roshan.
I'm trying to unmute him. Roshan. Okay, yes, Roshan Kumar is unmuted.
Roshan, sir, I cannot understand anything. Sir, I cannot understand anything.
Oh, okay. Sorry. So, can you be a bit specific? Like, is it literally nothing you are able to understand, or is it because of?
I have no any previous knowledge about this Git or GitHub, anything. I have no any previous knowledge.
Okay, I'll give another basic, you know, like still more basic version of it. All right.
Okay, sir.
Superb.
Okay, so now we'll take up Om Kumar, Om Bansal, right? Om Bansal, please. Hello?
My question is also same like Roshan Kumar.
Got it.
Okay, sir, what they're asking is...
My question is also like a Roshan Kumar, I don't understand.
Yeah, fine. So, sir, the basic question is that you should again, you know, tell them about what is Git and GitHub, because since people are not very familiar with what it is, so if you could do that again.
Yes, sure. Thank you. Let's do this. So, and I did get some feedback on going slower as well from a few people, which I'll do. Thanks. So, first thing is, let's see why we are using Git. Okay. So, let's say I have a couple of code. For example, this is some kind of a file which I'm using in my local computer. And let's say, I'm just putting some coding language here, like putting hello to everyone, and then I'm also adding some more code, some kind of a code, like hello world or something like this. Now, there should be, like, we are totally like 100 people right now, and I need to share the whole code with all these 100 people. What would be the best way I could... sorry, bro. I know only English and Tamil. English, Tamil, French, and Telugu. That's it. That's all the languages I know. I don't understand Hindi. Sorry. All right. So we've got this code, and it is really tough for everyone to access this code, right? Like there are like 100 people who can work on the same page. In that case, it should be there should be a way to collaborate with everyone. Collaborate in the sense everyone needs to, like all the 100 people needs to share the code and then contribute to the code. Like for example, let's say person A wants to add change the hello world to hello world all or something, hello all something needs to be done, then someone needs to add something like hello inside this one, something like that. In that case, it's gonna be a complete mess up if so first thing, this is the scenario. So there are like there are hundreds of people right now and everyone needs to change the code. In that case, what would be the best idea? Which you would say, like a couple of them, just try to add them in the comments. And I'll say why that might work, why that might not work. In case if that is not the right answer, I would say why that does not work. If it is the right answer, awesome, you are great. Any ideas? Start writing in your comments. The question is, what would be the best way? Like everyone, like 100 people here can edit this thing in the same time. Let's have like, Keshav, this is so bad. That's the right answer, bro. I can't talk anything about that. Okay, I'll hear from others as well. Okay, sharing the code online, that is nice. So sharing the code online and to make the code open to all is those are all almost similar. So what happens if everyone wants to change and I need to also get the change? Google Docs is one of the awesome way to answer that. Okay. The question is, we have like a single file code and then we need almost everyone to answer, I mean like everyone to change the code, and everyone needs to be on top of everyone's changes. Like for example, I have that hello to everyone here, hello all in the second line, and there is hello. Exactly, there will be a lot of things. People might duplicate the file and then, but the problem here is, in case if you share the unique link, let's say this is available in something like https://praveen.science/code.txt. And if you open this, the code is available, right? I will be able to change the code, but you all will not be able to change the code. That is the problem. So at this point, it is really, so I'll just take 3 to 4 answers, which are really good. All right. So the first thing is share the code online or make the code open to all. This will make that happen. But unfortunately, I will be the only person I will be able to edit. The other good idea is using Google Docs, which about like 3 to 4 people have said it's a good idea, but it would not be working out in case of you have like, let me actually share you a code which I am working on currently. And look at this number of code, like look at this whole number of code. There are like around hundreds of codes here, like hundreds of files here, and every file has different changes, and it's really, and every time when you do a change, you need to run and see if that is working or not. So considering these things, it would be really tough for everyone to keep up on top of the latest code. The latest code will be completely different from what you have. This is the current scenario. The topic is about Git and GitHub, and that is for today. Okay. Yes, Pranav, it's Visual Studio Code. So this is the current scenario. So since only one person will be able to edit the code, it is not an efficient way. Also, using Google Docs will not be the right choice, because when you are editing something, you need to also run it and see at the same time, it is really tough if multiple people start editing at the same time and it becomes a complete mess. So what is the yes, Pranav, it is Visual Studio Code, and Om Bansal, I guess I have told you this is about Git and GitHub. And Nirmal gave a good explanation that Git is a distributed version control system in simple words. Ishan, who's the source code on distributed version control system, so that one who wants change can fork it on your local machine and then commit the change. If the change causes some fault, we can revert back. This is one of the perfect answers. And that is what is the whole session about. Adarsh. Yeah, Adarsh, it is the same thing. Ripple or GitHub. Ripple is a good idea, but it is good for a small level of project, not for a huge level of projects. But yes, ultimately, the best way is to use GitHub. Let's see what exactly GitHub does. Okay, GitHub is a version control system, which means you as a user, you have your code in your system. Let me find a good illustration for you. Okay, how Git works or something like that. And almost all the images here are extremely huge, like it is very complicated. So I'll try to find if there is anything that is very easy to understand here and then explain it to you in that way. Okay, looks like everything is like almost, most of them are complicated. I'll just draw it and show you, that's easier. So let's say, let me open about blank and hope everyone is able to see my illustration as well. So I'm just gonna start illustrating things. Interesting, I'm not able to find any. Ionica, I'm not able to find any illustrations that I can do. So is there anything like it's not possible or something? Is it being disabled in this case?
No, annotate. We've done.
It's all right. I'll just use something like a draw or IO, like a. Okay, let's say, okay, we can use auto draw actually. That's really good. So let's say we have, this is my computer in home. Okay, so let me call this as P. And then I have some code here, right? I just completed writing the whole code. Okay, this is right now in my local home computer. So I'm just putting home here. Sorry about my handwriting. This is my home PC. And then I've got something written here at the moment. Okay. Now, what I do is when I save it, it is only available to this particular computer. So let's bring in one more thing, which is going to be a central repository or something like that. All right. And in this, this is another big computer here. So this is a big computer and where, oh, wow. Okay. So this is another big computer, which is a huge server. All right. And this one has, what I'm doing is I'm going to send the code to here. Okay. So whatever I wrote here, it's been sent to this. Now this server, what it says is it sees the code and then it accepts it. Okay, fine. What you have sent is a valid code. I will add it as a version one. Oops, I'll use the text. Okay, version one. So I've, right now the code will be available as version one at this point. All right. And now what I'm gonna do is I again write another set of code. Okay. And then I'll push it to the same computer. Now this computer will save this as version two on top of this version one. So this version 2 will be based on this version 1. Right now, do you understand what is happening? Like, if anyone don't understand, please either raise your hand or just comment it out. So I can assume that everyone is able to understand this. Shatakshi, do you want to talk? Shatakshi and Rahul and Roshan, a lot of people are raising their hands. Ayonika, do you want to schedule them to talk, please?
I'm doing that, just a minute. Shatakshi, Jeff, if you can speak.
Hello,
Shatakshi?
Yes.
Could you please explain what is happening?
Just be a little louder.
Could you please explain what is happening this time?
Yeah. Okay. So what I'm doing right now is I have a file in my hand, something like this file. I know this is kind of like So something like this file, and I'm starting to update this file. I created this file and then I saved this file locally. Now I want to make this available to everyone. So what I did was I kind of sent to a central repository. It is another computer which is available in public. Okay. So I sent first set of changes. Then again, I made some changes like adding another line or something like that. And then I sent it again to the central repository. This is what I have done. The central repository is a computer which actually tracks the code changes. So at the first time, it has my first line of code. Second time when I sent with my second line, it has my second line of code. So this is what I currently have. The central repository also currently has that.
Are you clear with it?
So the central repository has the changes that you have made.
Yes.
The home PC has a file, and when it is sent to the central repository, then the changes that have been made are tracked by the central repository.
Exactly. And it is almost similar like your Google Drive or what was the other one? Dropbox. So I guess most of you have used Dropbox, right? It is almost similar to Dropbox. This central repository acts like a Google Drive or Dropbox, which tracks the changes in the file. Got it?
Yes, sir.
Superb. So that is what is happening right now. Now, this is tracked in such a way that it is having the first version, which was created like 10 minutes ago. Then there is the second version, which was created like 1 minute ago. The difference between these two versions is you have added a new line, which says hello world or something like that. It is that way this central repo tracks for all the changes. All right. There are a lot of people who are saying go slower, and there are a lot of people who are saying go faster as well. So I'm just trying to keep up the pace. So sorry about that. If someone is annoyed, if you're not able to follow it, please let me know. I'll try to cater that. All right. Okay. Now the next thing is, let's say Shatakshi or someone comes as another participant here. So I'm going to create another computer here. So that's going to be another PC, which has, let's say it's a user PC. Okay. Let us say it's another developer. So now this person wants to have the complete set. So what this person does is, so this person is going to pull all the code from this one. It is called pulling. And what I did just now, like from here to here, is called pushing. Like it is just pushing and pulling the codes. So easy to remember. So when you're giving the code from here to here, you're just pulling it. And when you're giving the code from giving the code from your computer to the remote computer, it is called pushing. So now what you're doing is you're getting the pulling the codes, which are latest changes. And now what happens here is this person will have the both version 1 and version 2. Now what's going to happen here is this person is going to push another set of codes which is going to be tracked on this as version 3. Okay, so let me actually edit this one. So at the moment, what happens here is this person has version 1, version 2, version 3, while I would have only version 1, version 2. So, and I would be also noted. Okay, yes, actually, version 2 will not exactly overwrite the version 1, but it has the changes. The version 3 will be the active file. So when someone from outside tries to see the changes, like what exactly is there inside it, it's going to be the version 3's changes. That is the latest change. Is that clear? Like version 1 would be the first line. Version 2 would be the first line along with the second line. Version 3 would be the changes which is done by the dev 2 in this case. Now, at this point of time, what happens is, the central repo will tell me that I've got only one version. I mean, like I'm one version behind the latest version. So it is almost similar like your software updates. Hey, there is an update available. Do you want to get the latest version kind of thing? And then you need to start working, something like that. So what happens is, this central repository will tell me that there is a new version available and do you need to update your local branch? So what I do is I say yes, and then I pull the code. So this way I would be getting the latest version. So in that way, now my current version will be also version 3 here. But in this case, if you see this, this is going to be version 1 by Praveen, which is me. Version 2 is also by Praveen, and version 3 will be by dev 2. And then on top of version 3, I'll be doing a version 4, which is currently work in progress. Now, here is what we will be discussing about branching and how you're going to combine all these things. All right. Now, this person also decides to start his own version 4. Okay. So now we have version 4A and version 4B. Version 4A is by me and version 4B is by this guy. Okay, this dev2 guy. Now currently these two things are in work in progress. What happens now is whoever is completing first will be pushing the code. Okay, in that way what happens is mine will be committed as version 4. Yeah, I just pushed it now. So now my code is available here. Now this person will be intimated that, hey, stop working. You have a old code on top of which you are working. So stop right now, or you want to update your code. So what happens here is this 4B will become 5. And then right now there is a small disconnect at this point. And it will also give you a warning saying, not exactly warning, it will give you an information saying that there is updated code available. Technically, this will not be a problem because most of the developers, when they work together, we will be working on different files. If there is going to be the same file, we are kind of like slightly messed up. So Git is a software. This guy will be able to kind of check the codes. Okay, so Praveen has this code. The dev2 has this code. Let's try to merge it. Okay, this person has written something in the line 4, and this person has changed something in the line 3 or maybe line 10. And then we can easily, okay, this line needs to be added here. This line needs to be added here. This is the completed version. So this is called as three-way merging. So these kind of merges are easy for GitHub and Git, the Git as a software. The problem happens is when we both are like dev2 and Praveen, both of these people are editing on the same line. Git is not sure which line to be taking up. So in that time, it is called as a conflict, and that conflict can be resolved manually or automatically. So automatic conflict resolution is, people are like, Git is actually developing very fast. It is trying to think like a human using artificial intelligence and machine, not exactly artificial intelligence, but machine learning algorithms, etc. So they use this diff algorithm, which tries to find the difference between two versions and then tries to correctly give you the right answer. Like this is the ultimate file and stuff like that. So, but it is still a work in progress. Things are really improving further. At this point of time, it will say, okay, so I have this file from dev2. I have this file from Praveen. Which one do you want? Or do you want both the files, like both the changes? That's how Git asks. Literally, this is the question Git will ask you. Like, I have got this one from him. I have got this one from him. But instead of like telling the names, it will say, I have this changes in the current change. And I have this changes from the upstream. Which would you like to have? That is how Git will ask you, and you would be choosing either one or two or both. So that's what is going to happen. And this way you can have a central repository with a controlled version controlling. So people needs to give a permission. Okay, I want to put my version 4 onto the server. So please everyone accept that this is my version, which is called as a pull request or a merge request in other places. So pull requests, most of the companies, what they do is they try to get at least two approvals from the team members. Like for example, we have 100 people here. So out of this 100 people, two people needs to say yes, yes. And then the code will get merged. Everyone will be able to see what I'm gonna. Yes, that means Git is basically comparing between two different sources. Or two different, yeah, exactly. That works. Two different sources. That's perfect understanding. So can we quickly break for any questions? You can just comment out your questions. Okay, I assume that everyone understood, or those people who have not. Okay, got it. Thank you. So this is about the basics of how Git works. If there is no compatibility between the codes, then that's when the problem is there. That is when the conflict arises. So I'm not able to compare these two things. Which one do you want to take? That kind of a question Git will ask. Yes. Git will ask if there are changes from two different sources. That is first thing it will try to do a three-way merge. So let's take an example. Okay, I'll show you an example of a three-way merge. So this is an awesome software which I generally use for comparison. Okay, and it is called as Meld. It is basically for the Linux-based applications. But now I'm going to use this on. Yes, in the same link it will ask. Yes, it is not exactly a link, but it is a command line tool. It will be asking there. Let's say we will do a three-way comparison. Okay, now I'm just going to do a blank comparison. Right now there is no problem. So I'll do one thing here. So I'm going to put Praveen here and I'm going to put dev2 here. So right now itself you can see that these two things cannot be merged, right? So this is the problem with three-way merge. Now, Git will ask you whether you want Praveen or dev2 or you want both in this. That's how it will say. So I'm going to start writing a lot of code here. Let's say, hello world. So instead of code, we will start with a simple thing. We will start with just normal text, okay? So hello, InternWell. How are you? This is the first. This is what I started writing. And this is what is there in the central repository. So here I'm going to put Praveen and stuff like that. Then at this point of time, it cannot find that there is something like here. So at this point, I'm going to put another hello world. And the same way here, if I put hello InternWell, what are you doing? Oh, right. So it's going to be this way. So it's going to combine it in such a way that this needs to be. So at this point of time, it can clearly understand that there is only one thing in a difference. Like, for example, the Praveen is actually changed into dev2 or something like that. So do you want dev2 or Praveen? So if this one is newer, it's going to add it here. If this one is newer, it will be adding the Praveen here. But in case if these two things are not available, at this point is when Git gets confused and it will ask you whether you want the dev2 or Praveen in that case. All right. So now this is how Git works, and this is how Git merges happen. And this is actually done by the software called Git. And this is the software about. And any questions on the software as such? Like, that's how Git works. Okay, I'll continue with that. So now this is GitHub, and GitHub is a company or like a software, online software, which uses Git as a software in the backend, and then it will allow you to create new repositories, and then it will also help you with merging and other things. For example, I can show you a few things which is happening in Git repositories. So GitHub, let's say this is a repository which has a lot of code here, and then we can see a lot of commits as well. Like, GitHub is free. GitHub is completely free, and even private repositories are free. So if you see here, we can see that there are like loads and loads of commits here. Like, these are the commits which I was talking about. So there will be like, this is a commit from me. This is a commit from someone called Mysterious Coder, and stuff like that. And whenever a person is wanting to add a change, he will be using a pull request. So this is what I was talking about, pull request. And here, the GitHub shows like what are all the files changed and do you want to save it. So if that is the case, if you're okay to go for it, you can just do a squash and merge. You can do a lot of different ways to do. So these are like different ways. The other services like GitHub are, one is the GitHub, which we are talking about. Then there is something called Bitbucket. This is also a good service. Then there is another thing called GitLab. So these are the three competing software that is using Git as their backend, like backend software. So we will be concentrating more on GitHub because GitHub has the most number of users and usage as well. So for most of the open source software, GitHub is the only thing they are mainly going for. Any other questions? Okay, sure. Let's wind up by 3:10. That's perfect. So shall I take this time to go for the questions then in that case?
Sure, sir, as you like it.
Yeah, I guess we can. I mean, like, most of the people are like finding it hard to understand. So I would take this time to like explain if there is anything that I can explain them to make it like clarify it.
The next lecture class will be shared to you. The details will be shared to you.
GitHub is mainly used in most of the companies, most of the IT companies, where there are like loads and loads of files, like coding files that are available. And it is also shared among a lot of team members. Like, for example, I work for a company where there are like 5 people working on the front end. Real-time example is, I can even show my, I just show you the real code. So this is a project which I'm currently working on, which actually looks like this. So this is the project. It looks like this. So it is like your resume. You can create like your own resume in this way. This is what currently we are working on. And this file is powered by, the whole project is powered by this complete code. And there are like 48 commits in it. And there are many people working on it. This is a real-time example, which I can show you this way. And Git pull, Git fetch? That's a good question. So Git pull will completely take the changes and apply the changes in your local directory. Whereas Git fetch will just make sure what exactly, it will just try to understand what are all things that is being changed or what are all the changes are available. So Git fetch, Git pull is a combination of Git fetch and Git something like updating the local page as well. So something like that. So Git fetch will just try to get you the latest information. For example, if you do a Git status, it will tell you that whether you are back by, you are behind the code or you are ahead of the code or what exactly is the current situation. Yes, I can actually demonstrate the whole thing by creating a repository. Yeah, that is possible. Let me do it in the next session, because that's where we will be looking into a lot. Okay, another question is, if the same file, sorry, that question is like kind of like, can you clarify the question? Right. How is GitHub related to app development that we are going to do? So now, right now, we are like 100 people, around 100 people, right? Everyone needs to have the same code. So what we will be doing is we will be using Git as the version control system. And whoever changes the code will be able to push the code. And we'll be able to change the code and push it. And then we will be able to bring down the code. So this way, we are going to use GitHub in this case. So the app development which we are using is going to be using GitHub here. What is a repository in Git? Exact meaning. Repository is a folder. Like, for example, if you go to this particular thing, so Cats in Tech is a user or an organization, and this resume is a repository. A repository is a combination of, you can see it as a folder that contains a lot of files. That is the best thing I could explain. And in other terms, a repository contains a lot of branches. A branches will contain a lot of commits. A commit will contain a lot of changes. And everything is related to files. So you can see it in that way as well as this way. Can we share my Android app development code on GitHub with friends in order to divide the workload? Yes, definitely. I believe Android code which you are writing is using Java most probably, or maybe React Native, which is JavaScript. So yes, they are all text files, or even if it is like not a text file, you can use that to share with everyone. Is there any artificial intelligence was used in Git for comparison? What I said might have been a bit weird, but Let's find it out. What exactly is artificial intelligence? Artificial intelligence is nothing but machine learning. What is machine learning? Machine learning is based on statistics. What exactly is statistics? Hundreds and thousands of if then else statements. That's it. So to answer in direct way, the answer is yes. But to an extent, it is not exactly an artificial intelligence, but it does use some kind of fuzzy logic, which is kind of a part of artificial intelligence, but it is almost similar. That's what I would say. What exactly does version control means? Okay. Right now, whatever I have said this, like for example, when you have, this is like, let's say, I'll give you a better example. So this is something like Sublime Merge. So like, for example, this is, I'm not sure which would be the best way to show you here. So on Thursday, 24th October, 2019, I've got this file, okay? And later on, I've got this file changed to this way. So this is something like it's becoming, the changes are being tracked and tracked and tracked. This is the version controlling. So every single line is a version here. So previously on Saturday, November 9th, 2019, it was like this. On the next day, it became like this. So there are two versions. This is the previous version and this is the other version. So making sure all these versions are managed is controlling the versions. It is version controlling. And this management is called version control. And a version control software, one of the version control software is called Git. Is that clear? Sahej. Okay. It would be better if we summarize to clarify all the questions. That will also be better. Yeah, Pranav, that's Java. Yes. What other codes can be used in Git except Java? Well, that's a huge question. Let's say if we try to create a new repository here, it's gonna ask you what could be like, you know, it's like there are like, see here, there are like hundreds of different languages that you can use with Git. Anything, I mean, literally anything, like let it be Java, JavaScript, Python, C#, C++, .NET, ASP, VBScript, Visual Basic, like literally everything. Can we propose an edit, propose to edit rather modify code in any holder's account file? Yes, Sumana, the first thing is you are gonna do a proposal. Only when the proposal is accepted, you will be able to see the changes which is given for everyone, or else that is called as pull request. I'm going to develop an app. So should I work with Java or Kotlin? It depends, Rishi, Pranav. It is, if you are planning to use an Android app, whichever language you are happy with, comfortable with, go with that. That's my kind suggestion, because let's say if it is an Android app, you can actually use hybrid varieties to develop Android apps, like hybrid applications. For example, you can use React Native, you can use Cordova, you can use PhoneGap, you can use Java, you can use Kotlin, you can use, I don't think Swift can be used, that's for iOS. So there are like multiple languages that you can use for developing the same application, and there is very less differences between the things. So you go with, have a look at all the different codes. There will be different, like for example, I'm working on JavaScript, right? So I'm not sure whether I need to go with React.js, Vue.js, because these are the two things that are like completely competing. And if you see here, like for example, there are a lot of people, they kind of like try to compare between two different things. If you see this, this is actually doing the same application, one using Vue, one using React. They completely looked into intrinsic details on how Vue to do is done and React to do is done. How many files are being used, how the file structure are being used. When you do something like, for example, a clicking of the to-do, everything has been like done from, done in pure React, pure Vue. So this way I'm able to see, okay, I feel that React.js code is very easy to follow, I'll go with React. That's what I would say. So I would say the same suggestion for you. Try out both the things, whichever you are comfortable. Try with a small application so that you don't waste much time. So whichever you are comfortable with, go with that. That's what I would say. With respect to Java, Kotlin, etc., I have literally no clue, bro. And sorry, because I have been working only with JavaScript and I haven't worked in any Android application. So if I say any suggestion, it would not be the right one. So anyone who is who will be able to answer these questions in the chat can answer it. Like, is Kotlin based on Java, or which is better, Kotlin or Java or something like that? I haven't used either, so I'm not the right person to answer that. Let's go with the other questions. You're welcome, Pranav. Ishan, what is the difference between version control and continuous integration? That's actually a good question. So whenever you are doing just this kind of like saving the code in different versions and spreading to everyone, everyone is able to download it and do those things. That's until that, it is a version control system. When it goes beyond that, that's going to be a continuous integration. So it is actually CI/CD, they say. Continuous integration, continuous delivery, which means when you push the code to the main branch, generally the main branch is called as master branch. When a new change is pushed into the master branch after the pull requests are approved, this continuous integration tool, it does a few things. Okay, I got a new code in the master branch. I need to look into the code, make sure the code runs. So there is a test runner that runs first. It first builds the code. Okay, so this is a code based on say Java or maybe a node code which needs to be compiled. So it first compiles it. It checks whether this whole build process works. If it works, fine, nice. We will go to the next step. Next step is gonna test every functionality, whether it works. Almost all the code right now are using test driven development, or a lot of unit tests are written in that. So in that case, it is going to run all the unit tests one by one, and then it will be checking whether this code, whatever the code that you have proposed in master, is working. Once every test is passed, only then there will be this pull request being approved and getting merged will happen to the master. But after that, it will also do another test. Once all these tests are done, everything seems like perfect. Okay, now the tests are passing, everything is done. The next step is to publish it somewhere. For example, this is a website, app.resume.best. So now the code is working fine, everything works. Now I need to copy the files, the built files, to this server to make it available for everyone. This is what is called continuous delivery or deployment. This is the deployment phase. We will be learning this as well in the course. This is the whole process of writing the front end, writing the back end, compiling the code. In case if we need writing the test, it will be a boring concept for sure. I'm not going to take that. Then once we do this, we will connect the domains with it, and then we will be publishing the website as well. This is what the whole process is. This is the difference between version control. Version control is just a part, and then the next part is CI/CD. So that's the difference. You cannot actually say it as a difference. You're asking like, what is the difference between a undergraduate degree and a postgraduate degree? So first you need to do the undergraduate degree, then you need to do the postgraduate degree. So that's how first you need to make sure your version controlling is done. And then once the version control is done and the master code is released, and then you'll be doing the release. That's called continuous integration. Then let me go to the next one. From where should we start the basics of web development? What should be the basic? Okay, web development, the basic thing is HTML, CSS, the front end, then JavaScript, those kind of things. So we can start with that. That would be the next session after Git. I could give you a lot of like insights on, if you have like zero clue about that, I can give you a lot of insights on how you can get started with them. That is possible. Is fetching different from pulling? I did answer this before. So fetching is a part of pulling. So fetching is trying to fetch the information of the current repository, the code, which is available in the server. So your local system, you have got the code with you. Someone from your teammate might have pushed the code. New code will be added to the server. At that point of time, you don't know if that code is pushed or not. If you do a Git status, if you try to check the status, you will say that everything is fine, everything is up to date, only you are working. That's what it would say. If you do a fetch, it will go to the server, remote server, and ask for, do you have any changes for me? This is my current situation. Let's say this person has got like say Praveen has got a few files which are saved and which are not tracked, which are modified. And then this is the current state. This is the last change he has got in his repository. Do you have any changes for me? That's what your computer will go and ask the remote server. Remote server responds, yes, there is a change. It is by dev2. He has done another push which has these changes. And do you want to tell this to Praveen? And then that comes and says, okay, these are the changes that's been there. And your branch is out of sync. Actually, your branch is just behind. You might like to pull the latest code and start working on top of it. That's what is going to save. So this is the fetch area. Now, when you do pull, it does all this fetching thing. And then, okay, yeah, so there is new code available. So I'm going to pull the code. So I'm going to get the latest code from the remote and then update it in the local. This is what is the difference between fetching and pulling, where fetching is a process inside pulling. Is that clear? Okay. Awesome. So any more questions? I guess did I not answer any of your questions? Please tell me. Like, I guess we have another 5 minutes, right?
So we do have time till 3:15. So if anyone of you wants to ask a question, kindly type it in the chat box now.
Okay, we've got 5 minutes. And one more thing is, I can also provide you with the basic, like, you know, this is my first time, so I can understand that a lot of people might have been bored by the way I talked. So sorry about that. And I can also send you some nice, awesome YouTube videos, which can explain the Git in a more different way, in a more basic way, which I'll explain that too. Thank you. Redux. Redux is a completely a different concept. It's a state management software where you will be able to, this is mainly for a third party state management in case of a reactive programming language like Angular, React, and Vue. These three languages have their own way of managing the states, but they all lack in certain way where you need to do a prop drilling to get the state value. In case if it is gonna be if you want to make it in a better way, we can use some kind of a third party software like Redux. This is what Redux is. It's a state management software. It's a third party program. It's a third party library, which can be used with any of these reactive languages. So today, let me quickly have a quick summarize of what all things which we did today. So today what we did was, we first got to know about what was our audience, and then we started with Git, GitHub. What is the difference between Git and GitHub? Then finally, we went to how Git works and how GitHub can help you in automating the whole thing, like the whole process of software development. These are the things which we saw today. In the next class, next session, we will be looking at the basics of front end and web development as a whole, like how you would be starting with the web development thing. And we will also start creating repositories, new repositories, and everyone will be doing the same thing. And that would be a good way to start with. All right.
Any questions? We are on the end of the class. Okay, so sir, everyone is thanking you. Yeah, fine. So we'll wrap up with this class. Sir, anything else?
Thanks a lot for keeping up with me, taking my boredom, and sure, we will try to make, I'm gonna try to make this as interactive and as interesting as possible. But yes, stay tuned. Let's meet us all in the next class as well. All right.
Okay, so we'll end the class.
See you all. Have a nice day. We can stop the session.